Well, good evening to all of you. It's been a long journey getting to this place right here tonight. And I also want to say Happy New Year. I don't think I've seen any of you since the new year began. And we have a whole fresh start ahead of us, don't we? I love new tennis shoes for that reason. I love the new school year for that reason. It's that sense that there's fresh hope up ahead, that there's good things up ahead. I also have to tell you that it helps my fear, honestly, just to look at all your faces. It helps quell my fear. So many of you are just so dear to me. It's my church family, and I know that you sit here with a lot of grace toward me tonight, and I really need that. I'm a complete newbie to this, by the way, if you don't know me. This is a stretch for me, so. And I have to tell you a secret. What I've told myself to make myself feel better is not the naked joke that you're all naked, but is that they've paid you to be here instead of you paid to be here so that you could help me to show up and be brave like God is asking me to do. And you know what? I really want to be brave tonight. It's hard to be brave sometimes, isn't it? It's to step past your own fears and your own humanness and your own inadequacy and step out and say, you know what, God, I'm going to trust that you're a whole lot bigger than I am and that you're going to do this in spite of who I am and who I'm not. And so that's where I am tonight. Before I go any further, though, I want to show you something here. Is this not amazing? This isn't me. I'll just tell you. This is Emily and Erica. They made this beautiful little book that looks refreshing. It does. But just to direct your focus here for a minute, just the first page is a note from me to you, and you can read that in your own time. But what we need here is the listening guide for the first one. So before you get any sort of false preconceived ideas about this, we have no fancy little screen up there that's going to flash that. We're not that high tech. This is a you and me in on this, and this is going to help you stay awake and maybe earn you a cupcake if you fill yours in correctly. How's that? And the good news is if I go too fast, because I might, just know that each one of these is actually the lead-in for each day. So you will find the actual whole sentence, that's the secret, in your study for this next week, if that makes sense. So each of these are listed per day. So check there if I go too fast for you. And I am going to try to pause, God willing. But whatever happens, we'll all survive, won't we? That's the good news. What I do want to say is that, oh my goodness, you guys, so many of you in this room, whether it's from a Facebook page or being my friend or being part of my church body, a lot of you are aware of the chaos of the last few years of my life, several years of my life, and you've prayed for me and you've watched us as a family go through a major medical story and for it to go away a way that we never wanted it to end. What you saw was the visible story. We often look at each other and we see visible stories, don't we? But there's always the story that you don't see going on in people's lives. And so tonight and over the next 4 weeks, what I'm going to do, and this is a giant leap of faith for me, just so you know, is I want to pull back the curtains a little bit further on my life, and I want to share with you, there will be some of Aaron, my boy's story, in there, but it's not so much a retelling of that story, is it's a telling of my story of faith in regards to his story. And it's going to stretch me a lot, and I'm praying like crazy that I won't cry along the way, but I can't promise that. So if I start crying, you pray that I get it together and that we get back on the road again, because I really, really want to take this leap of faith, because I believe with all my heart that our lives reflect God to each other, that sometimes we're so up against our own life that we can't see him as clearly as we can sometimes see him in the movement of someone else's life. And so I want to take this leap of faith, and I want to trust him for what he's going to do with it in your life as I tell you my story and as I hold up the passages that have come to mean so much to me, and then you look through and share in some of the key stuff that he's given me that's helped me walk and survive through that. So that's my heart and my goal, is just to share with you in a more in-depth way and let him do with that what he wants to do with that. I do want to start with a question. Might seem out of left field, but it's not. When you guys think about God, is he a God of expectation? Are we down here and he's looking at us and he has expectations over our life? Is he expecting something from us? You know, this last week I was in Sedona with my family, and we were having a late Christmas. When you have 20 and 30 year olds, no schedules collide at good times, so you just create your own Christmas. So that's what we did. So we in Sedona, Arizona, and you know, I've tried to learn over the years, don't create expectations, because some wise person once said, our expectations and our reality and what lives in here, disappointment. Our disappointment lives in the space between our expectations and our reality. And so I've tried to just go with more anticipation than expectations. But I have to be honest, this time around, I still went with expectations. I just wanted a good family picture. Is that too much to ask? Seven of us in the same frame at the same time, looking coherent enough to share a Happy New Year card with our friends and family. I didn't think that was big expectations. I bet you can guess. And I was even thinking maybe I would have three to choose from. With a whole week, who knew? Maybe I would have multiple good ones to choose from. But you know what? No, that didn't happen at all. Our reality happened, and we didn't come away with one family picture. So for any of you who I said I would be sending out pictures to, I won't be sending out pictures. So that's just a side note there. But I do want to ask you again that same question. I want to ask you, in your life, in your thinking, do you think of God as a God of expectation over your life? I want you to hold on to that. When I think back as a young girl of my story, were you that young girl? Did you sit there and envision maybe just how it might go? You saw older people, you saw them getting married and having babies, and you start envisioning what your life might go like. And I have to tell you, when I look at my life, I might be wrong, but honestly, I can only come up with two things that went the way I thought that I hoped that they would. And that was marrying the only guy I ever dated. That's a whole different story. But and the other one was having five kids. For whatever reason, I thought that it would be great to marry the only guy you dated and to have five kids. Sound perfect to me. And so I did. And I wonder if you all had a moment to think through what you would find about your own life, how much of it aligns with those dreams and thoughts and expectations that you might have had for your own life. God's word says that none of us come to Jesus unless God the Father draws him. And I felt that drawing at about 5 or 6 years of age. I grew up in a very conservative home, and every Sunday night at church, the gospel was preached. So ever since I was knee-high to a grasshopper, I heard the gospel every Sunday night. And really, a lot of it was trying to entertain yourself. We didn't have phones and we didn't have all those gizmos then. You just sat there and tried to entertain yourself for an hour until it was done, was the reality. But you know, one night, in my little five-year-old heart, I felt that need and I felt that quickening. And so I prayed that child's simple prayer of that Christ would receive my request and that I would become his. And so, truth be told, I had no real understanding at that point, like what I was saved for, like this intimate relationship with Jesus Christ. I was more thinking about what I'd been saved from, like going to hell. And so that was my reality at that point. But I wasn't too young to begin forming a composite of who I believed God to be. And we all have them, don't we? Whether they're true or whether they're not, whether they have part truth or not, we all have a composite of who we believe God to be. And how did we come up with that composite? For myself, at tender age of 5, I really believe as I began to think about God and being aware of him, I think it probably went something like this, that ever since I was in my high chair, every morning, my dad read the Bible to us, except Sunday mornings because we were going to church. So I guess that was enough. But I heard the Bible going in, and then I'd go to Sunday school, and I would be taught things. But you know what I believe more than anything impacted my composite? Is the humans that were around me. Don't we do that? We look at humans, and because he's unseen, and he's more surreal to us, that the humans that form our life around us often make up somewhat the composite. So we have this little mishmash. We come to know him, and we have this little mishmash of who we believe him to be. And that's where I was. I had this little beginning composite of putting these little pieces together of this unseen and unknown God to me. But you know, even as I was going about my life on a farm in Eastern Washington, number 7 out of 9 kids, whatever I thought of him, he was faithfully and fully and truly who he always will and always will be. Who he's always been and who he always will be. Wow, I got that out. At this point, look at number 1 in your book and we'll put that in. And that number 1 is this. None of my false ideas of who he is will ever change him. None of my false ideas of who he is will ever change him. You know, in my little composite, I now had this word called Savior. I knew he was my Savior. I'll tell you what, though, that was probably as big of an understanding as maybe our rescue dogs, that when we get them, that they know that somehow they've been saved from not such a good thing and that life is perhaps looking a little better than it used to. And that's probably about where I was. But you know, the wonder of that transaction of Christ coming into our life, of becoming alive to him, that's a miracle, isn't it? I think sometimes we're so inundated with the everydayness of life that we really forget the wonder of what lives within us, and that we, when we've accepted him, are alive to him. Like access, heaven, we have access to heaven through requests, through seeking him. It really is a miracle. Let's turn to Matthew 27 for a minute. What I want to do is I know that the story of salvation of the gospel is well known to all of us, but I want to look at it again tonight. So turn to Matthew 27. And the thing about the gospel is this, and I'm finding this more and more, is that I know back a while ago I thought, you know what, I'm saved, that's done, and now I'm doing life, I'm learning about God. And that's true. But our salvation is a touchstone forever for us. I think of Johnny Erickson. I was reading the other day how she was saying that, you know, she's paralyzed from the neck down. And so she can wake up in the middle of the night. She might be paralyzed, but she still experiences great pain. So she's laying there in excruciating pain. And you and I would just roll because it hurts right there. And we'd get off it. But she can't move. And in that desperate place of knowing that she's got to wait till someone wakes up, she lays there in pain and wanting to give up and just tired of fighting through life. And you know what she said at that point? She starts preaching the gospel to herself because it's the power of God in our life. It's our true north. It's our identity. And so I never want to stop reaching out to that touchstone of the gospel. This is my identity. This is my true north. Let's go ahead and look at verse 45. So Jesus has been convicted of being false, even though he was fully true and fully God. He was convicted of being false, and now he's been hung on a cross. He's mocked, beaten, scourged, and he's hanging on a cross for us. A robber is on either side of him, and in verse 45, I want you to just note this verse. It's so benign. Look at the words that are contained in this verse and yet the enormity of what it's saying. Now from the 6th hour, darkness fell upon all the land until the 9th hour. All of redemption, all of salvation was taking place in those 3 hours of darkness. And here's just this verse. Isaiah 53:5 tells us what's happening in that darkness. You don't need to turn to it. I'll just read it to you. It says, "He was pierced through for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The chastening, the punishment for our well-being fell upon him. And by his scourging, you and I, all of us, are healed." Healed, made alive to him. That's what those 3 hours of darkness were about when we reach out and receive that. You know, there's so much contained in that when you think about, when I think about my own life and what I've done, and that all of it, and even what I don't know yet that I'm going to do, all of it was paid for there. But I think of verse 46. Let's read that together. "About the ninth hour, there at the end of the 3 hours, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,' that is, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?'" You know, I remember the day that I went to our sticky little crusty Gig Harbor Theater. Do you remember that one before the glitzy one we have now? It was crusty. My feet stuck to the floor. But I remember the day that I went there to watch The Passion of the Christ. And Mel Gibson did an amazing job, and just, you could hear crying all over the theater. And I remember just the shock of stumbling out into the light of day and you know, wiping the mascara off your face. But what was so preeminent in my mind as I walked out of there is, you know what, I've always thought about how horrible, and listened to the stories of what it meant to be scourged and these different things. And yet in that moment, I knew that being separated from the Father was the most devastating thing that took place. And you see that. Look what he's saying. He's saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? It wasn't, why is this load so great? Or why is this going on so long? It was, why have you forsaken me? I think that's for us too. You can go ahead and look at your book again for number 2, and we'll fill that in. And it says this, "So too, you and me, our greatest whys most often originate in our moments of feeling forsaken by him." You know, we're promised that we're never forsaken by him, but it doesn't mean that we can't feel forsaken sometimes. Spilling out of the theater that day, there was a lot going inside my heart. It wasn't just about what I had witnessed on the screen, but it was what I had begun to live in accordance with. My composite definitely had false pieces in it. I'll explain that to you a little bit more. I was in full service to a self-formed God of expectations. Yes, I did believe that God has expectations of me. I grew up in a house where there was no TV and no radio. We lived on a farm, and so we entertained ourselves outside playing with the animals, running around the hills, and board games, card games, wrestling. That was life, and it was a good life. I was one that absolutely loved puzzles. That was my go-to. Questions and puzzles, all good. I love a mystery. I love something to figure out and break down. And so I happened to be drawn to this little game called Perfection. You know that game? First of all, I just want to ask, what crazy human being creates a game for children called Perfection? I have issue with that, honestly. But have any of you played? Yeah. Okay, I'm going to explain to you who did not play so you get this. Okay, so it's this rectangular game, and it's picture yellow, red, and blue. And it has this little platform that is spring-loaded. So you push it down, and on this platform are 25 little indentations of different shapes. Star, circle, moon, whatever. 25, you understand that. Along with that comes 25 little yellow pieces that match them that you're supposed to fit in. But my friends, that's not all. There's a little timer. And that little timer just rules you loser or winner, no grace. Just you're a winner, you're a loser, because if you don't get all the things in there before it pops and throws all your work out, you're a loser. So I liked this game, strangely enough. I loved it. But one day, my dad decided to add a new twist. We had out-of-town company, which was a regular thing for us. And he called me over to demo the game for our visitors. And so he loaded that little thing, pushed the off button so that you could screw the timer up. And then I noticed that he gathered all the pieces up in his hand, and he held them. And he pushed the go button. He just kept holding them. And I realized, oh, my heart just kicked up a beat. This is a different game and everybody's watching. And so I just sat there and stared at his hands. And when he let go of those little pieces and they landed on the carpet, I just went into overdrive. I believed with all my heart that it was my job to get those little pieces in before that thing went off. It didn't matter how much time I had or didn't have. And so this became the new version of that game. No matter how long my dad held those pieces in his hand, I came to really believe in some stupid, strange way that it was my job not to let him down and to do what I thought that I was called to do in that moment. To everyone else, I think looking on, this is fun and games, you know? But to me, unbeknownst to me, it began to be a way of life for me. It began to be about my Heavenly Father and pleasing him and trying to figure out what he wanted from me as the timer of life was going on in my life. So it became that whether it was a middle school, my middle school teacher or a new friend or my mom, I found myself unknowingly sizing up situations, perceiving what I thought was expected, and trying to take my resources and myself and fit that into what the expectations were. You know what? It's really hard to play perfection with each other. It's mind-numbing. It's degrading to who we are. But it is absolutely devastating to play perfection with God. You know why? He doesn't give you the pieces. I know this. I know this for a fact. He won't release the pieces. He doesn't play the game. And you know why? Because his ways are life-giving. They're not soul-destroying like that. We could all share these silly types of little stories, couldn't we, of what formed us and shaped us in life? My story isn't some noteworthy story or worth really talking about. But one day, God brought this picture of this game of perfection. You know the funny thing is, I never realized what the name of that game was till that day, when he brought this clarity of this picture to me of perfection that I had been playing in an answer to some of my requests of him. By then, I was married, living on this side of the mountain, and I had my 5 children. One girl and 4 boys. 4 boys and then a little girl that came along and brightened our life. Life at that point, you guys, was rich and full, but it was hard and confusing for me, honestly. I had this expectation, yes, I had expectations of myself too, along with all the expectations of other people and of God that I was working diligently to fulfill. But it was exhausting thinking about this family and having expectations of what I thought a Christian family should look like, what direction we should be moving, what that should look like, maybe even what that timetable should be. And so this is where I was in that. But you know, the most painful part of being in that space and time in my life wasn't that my husband really wasn't participating in this plan of mine, or really my children were either, but it was truly this sense that as much as I wanted it to be, God and I weren't on the same page. I just had this sense that he wasn't playing the same game as me. And the reason why I felt that way is because things just began to unhinge in our life. Just literally one thing after another. And I need you to know something, you guys. I might sound like a bit of a control freak up here, but I honestly don't believe, there was some of that, I'll own that. you wanna get people you love to where they're supposed to be, don't you? But I honestly, by this time in my life, I honestly had a living desire for God. I wanted to get what he wanted me to get. I just didn't get it. And so you can see that day as I left the theater, the ache in my heart, it wasn't just about what I'd viewed, but it was the heaviness of the weight of my life that I had begun to carry. It was this sense of, you know, what exactly does this Christian life look like in real time? I'm trying really hard here. On the intense days, I might jokingly say to John, you know, I think all the humans got a memo on how we're supposed to do life, and I think I was absent that day because I don't know how this is working. And I would think, you know, maybe, just maybe, if he hadn't come to mean so much to me, that I could just shrug it off and say, I'm having bad luck, you know, it'll change, who cares? But he did mean a lot to me, and I did want to get it, and I wasn't getting it. So the storm clouds of our life kept gathering, and I remember one day some of our dear friends, half of them is in the room tonight, said to us something along this line. They said, you know, if your life is feeling extra hard right now, we figure you have a solid 8 of the 10 top things that cause couples to divorce. And I was like, wow. You know, that brought a strange comfort to me because I thought, okay, that helps to know that it's hard and there's something going on here. But another part of it thought, you know, it's not so bad that I'm noticing, but now other people are noticing that my life's kind of not in such good shape at this point. Let's go ahead and look at number 3 and we'll fill that in. Somehow in my theology, I had come to see him, not as a source of supply, but of demand, a God of expectations. Say that one more time. Somehow in my theology, I had come to see him, not as a source of supply, but of demand, a God of expectations. You know, it wasn't for lack of knowing the Word of God. Like I say, ever since I was in a high chair, I heard the Word of God going in. I could quote verses. But somehow where I was at in my life at that point, the truth of those things wasn't penetrating into the deeper parts of me to change my thinking, to change my composite yet of what I was holding about him to be true. Let's look at number 4 next. This is a strange one, but I really mean it. It really landed on me one day, and it says this: I now know it is possible to be a woman who is saved by the blood of Jesus, serving him, enjoying and learning his word, and yet participating in a malfunctioning relationship with him. I'll say it one more time. I now know it is possible to be a woman who is saved by the blood of Jesus, serving him, enjoying and learning his word, and yet participating in a malfunctioning relationship with him. And you know, that isn't to make us wonder or cringe at that point or self-examine, because you know, the whole point is salvation is the start point, isn't it? He takes us with great grace and leads us forth. And that's what his word is for, is to teach us who he is, who the truth of who he is, and to eradicate the things that have come into our life through perhaps human interaction that we've begun to believe and project what perhaps another human has done to us on him. And we think of him as like that, and he's not. And so there's great grace for us in that. He walks with us through that. And you know what? As much as we all hate our struggles and our trials, they are the rich, ripe ground I have found for knowing him, the truth of who he is, for letting him reveal himself to us. And so in this season of our life, it seemed like God, like a surgeon with a scalpel, was slowly touching each area of our life. And I think the best way to describe how that felt was kind of like when you're caught in the ocean and a wave catches you off guard. And you suck in and a wave goes over your head and you come up and you're gasping for air. And that's kind of how it began to feel. I promise everything over these 4 weeks will not be this heavy. We got to get through the little bit of the hard stuff, so bear with me. These are the realities that I need to let you know. And so what were some of those waves? Financially, the housing market crashed. And guess what we did for a living? We sold building materials. It had been going really well. And suddenly thousands of people are walking away from their homes. There's literally whole industries just popping up for people to just clean out empty houses. Do you remember that? And we're out and about trying to sell building materials to people. You know what? It was only a matter of time till we had to walk away from our own house too. So there was many pressures that way. Financial things touch every area of our life, don't they? But they absolutely pale in comparison to relational challenges in our life. Those are at a whole different level. One of our sons came out to us. He told us he was gay in high school. And I'll have to tell you, nothing equipped me for that. Parenting is kind of, you do stuff somewhat by the seat of your pants and with a whole lot of prayer, right? You know, you don't have a manual. You just figure it out as you go and you do a lot of praying. But to suddenly be presented with this, that our son had told us that he was gay, I had never felt so ill-equipped or unsuited for what that meant for us as parents. I didn't know what that meant. And I didn't know what that looked like, being a Bible-believing family. And in those days, when that kind of thing happens, I don't know if any of you have experienced this, but with all your heart, you're trying to reach out to your child, but somehow in all the not understanding the circumstances, it just seems like you keep hurting each other through that process. It's very painful thing. And so that was another wave of ours. And then another wave that had come in at this point was divisiveness between me and my family of origin. Came from a big family, a Christian family, but divisiveness had just come in about how you live out that Christian life. And so where once we had a place in Eastern Washington to go to experience the farm life and ride the combine and go to family reunions and that, it was just deafening silence in that area of our life. But I'll tell you this, I remember the day that I realized that it was our marriage that had been touched next. And I'll tell you, I might struggle with a lot of things, but by nature I don't struggle a lot with anger. But I just felt an anger. I can't hardly describe that day, an anger and a hurt. And I just thought, you know, God, is there nothing sacred in my life that you won't choose to touch? Is there maybe perhaps something that you will protect and not touch? But it was truly the medical condition of our 13-year-old son, Aaron, our middle child, that really rose out of the middle of all these things and demanded our full attention. At 13, he had been diagnosed with a rare liver disease. Many of you know some of this story. But he'd been diagnosed with a rare liver disease, and often with autoimmune conditions, it comes in a cluster. And so he had two predominant diseases. One was ulcerative colitis in the bowel, and the other one was his liver disease. And so what that looked like in our life was the liver disease is quiet and deadly and just is slowly going downhill, so you lack energy. But the bowel is noisy and obtrusive and is just in your face all the time. It's what took us to the hospital, and it's what interrupted his schooling, and it's what was in front of us all the time. So 10 years into that process of trying to get him his autoimmune response in his body into remission after 10 years and multiple drugs, it never happened. And so they decided, his team decided that they were going to take out his bowel, his large, and they were going to create an ostomy. And then when he healed, they would hook him back up. And then they told us we would have at least another 5 to 8 years before we needed a liver transplant. Which liver transplant, that's a big deal, but they're very common and they have very good results. So I felt we had a game plan. It was a hard game plan, but it was a game plan. But you know what? That one came apart at the seams too. We went in for the surgery in October, and it went picture perfect is what the surgeon's words were. And 4 days later, Aaron went into crisis and they wheeled him into the OR. All I can say at this point is that if I thought our life had been tough then, it went to a whole different level at that point. They lost him twice on the operating table, and due to a blood clot, he was now minus his large intestine and almost all of his small intestine. the surgeon came out and said, you know what, look, I should have let him go, but he's only 23 years old and I couldn't handle it. So quite honestly, I have no idea if he can sustain life, but I couldn't let him go. And so that's where we were at. So 40 days later, we brought home this boy that was fragile and with huge medical needs. And none of us, including the medical team that we had there, knew what was next. We were all consulting the internet at that point. So our days now look like me learning how to hook up medical stuff and hook up his liquid food into his arm. And John, my husband, got on the internet at night and just started researching and watching videos of transplants and realized through his process of elimination that the closest place that could do Aaron's transplant was UCLA Medical Center down in Southern California. And we realized that Aaron would need 4 organs to sustain life. So we began that process. At this point, our life became wrapped up in 2 things, actually 3. It was keep your phone on you at all times and in every place. Don't get so many miles away from a major airport. And do everything you can every day to keep Aaron alive so that we can make it there. And so whatever the state or the condition of all the other waves of our life, this was all of our focus right now. It was everything that consumed us. Even as this yellowish green tinge, you guys saw it, began to overtake his body, I felt fear in tandem overtaking my life. It wasn't that, I want to be clear about this because I think sometimes, maybe I'm the only black and white person in the room, but we can be all or nothing about this. We can think, oh, you don't have faith about that. But you do have faith about that. God's word was a support to me. People were praying with me, meeting me for coffee. I was studying the word. I was attending Bible studies when I could and knew that Aaron was in a safe place for a couple hours. But the overall true belief of my heart, deep down inside, the thing that you would never tell anybody, is I had this desperate sense that in this equation that I had set up of how God works, that somehow I had gotten it wrong, and all of us were paying the price for that. That was terrifying to me. I didn't know how to fix that, and I was certainly trying to. You know, I just felt so frustrated with him. I can't tell you how many times I'd ask him, like, okay, it keeps getting worse. I keep wanting you more. Why does life keep getting worse? What does this mean? What am I doing wrong? Just tell me what to do and I'll do it. That's the point I was at. You know, God is so much different than what my words are describing to you about who he is. I want to turn to Romans 8 right now together because I want to just soak in that place of the truth of who he is. This may be where I really was, but it's not where he really was. We'll look at verse 31. Start there. Paul is speaking to us, and he's doing this defense of the gospel and its power to both save and sanctify us. And we don't have a lot of time to go into it, but from telling us that all things work together for good to telling us about being predestinated, he's setting forth who God is and how he works and what he does. He's grounding us like that. And then comes this verse 31. And I'll read 31 through 34 right now. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also, with him, freely give us all things? Who will bring a charge against God's elect? God is the one who justifies. Who is the one who condemns? Christ Jesus is he who died, yes, rather who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who also intercedes for us. We'll look at the rest in just a minute, but I want us to hear this clearly, because do you hear this choice thing, this designation of Paul separating it out, and he's saying, who is against us? Which Who is it that's against us? God's not against us. He gave us his son. If we believe God's against us, where's that coming from? Where's that coming from? What's the next question he asks? It's in verse 33. Who will bring a charge against us? Who's making a judgment call against your life right now? Is God doing that as he looks at you as his child, if you belong to him? Is he making a judgment call about your life right now? Who will bring a charge against us? In verse 34, he says, who is the one who condemns us? So he's going through and he's challenging us back and forth to recognize what's happening in our thinking, in my thinking. Who is against us? Who will bring a charge against us? Who is the one who condemns us? You know what? There's a defense for each one of those. It's not God who is against us. He sent his son. It's not him who brought a charge against us. He's the one that justified us. He's the one that provided salvation for us. For him to bring a charge against us would be the charge against his own work. He's the justifier. Is he the one who condemns us? Are we living under shame or condemnation in regards to God in our life? He's not the one that condemns us. Yea, he was the one that went to the cross. And now where is he? He's literally sitting at the right hand of God interceding for us. There's not condemnation in his heart toward us. These are the things that my heart needed to believe at that point. I needed to be in the goodness and the fullness of that. I love that next stretch, 35 to 39, due to time, and we're running a little bit later. I'm not going to go through and read it, but his question there is again, who will separate us from the love of Christ? And then he goes on in five beautiful verses to just stress that there is nothing unseen or seen that can interrupt that flow of God's heart toward us. Is there times that we need to go before him and own what we've done? Yes, yes. And have that conversation with him. But it has nothing to do with condemnation. Nothing to do with condemnation. He is for us and he's not against us. You know, these truths, one, have changed my reality. We walk through what God brings into our life, don't we? We know the end of the story. He's told us the end of the story. And he gives us his companionship in his strength, and we have all the resources of heaven to ask for as we face these things, but we still have to walk with through them. But you know what? It wouldn't have changed the circumstances, but it would have made all the difference. Whatever is in our life, if we fully and completely believe that God is for us, it makes such a difference. If we really believe whatever state we find ourselves in today, that God is utterly for us, that there is nothing in his heart of condemnation or judgment against us, that has been settled at the cross. That his heart is for us and everything that he is allowing in our life is an invitation from him. That's what I didn't understand, you guys. I didn't understand that each of these things was an open-hearted invitation from God to know him in ways that I could never know him in other places. It's not stuff we want. It's hard stuff. But I didn't see it that way. But you know what? He was going to stick by me and stick with me because great is his faithfulness, right? We sang that. He doesn't give up on us. And his desire is that we would know him fully in truth, that our composite would just continue to be more and more alive and in truth to him, that we respond to other people and we deal with life and we walk through life in truth with him, because life is hard enough without believing that he's against you in some way too, or he doesn't have your back or your heart. At this point, you know what? I desired him, but I was terrified of him, honestly. I was at the point that I wasn't sure how to live with him or without him. I just took care of life and did what I needed to do next in that time. And then, you know what? The phone rang, and the call came from UCLA. It was time to head down to California. They had potential organs for Aaron. And I knew in my heart of hearts, I'd been laying in bed each night and imagining what was ahead, trying to imagine what was ahead, and trying to not think about what was ahead the other half of the time. But in that interim of waiting, I knew that things were going to change and up the ante yet again, because whereby here I had been going through those things, I was surrounded by godly friends, many of you in this room. I was surrounded by a church family. I had my family. And you know what? I had my house. When you just were going to lose it, you had a house to go home to. But I knew that as it came time to head down to California, as I looked around for someone else that might be going, I knew it was going to be me. I knew that I was the mom and I was the available one and I wanted to be there. But I felt extremely afraid and extremely inadequate for what was up ahead. And I had a God of expectation to go along with me. And so that's honestly where I was when the phone rang, to realize that this is what's next. I don't know where I'm going to live. I don't know where I'm going to go. I don't know how long it's going to be. And I only part understand what they're going to be doing to our boy. That's where I was. That's where my heart was. I wish I could end on a happier note, but there's four nights. So there will be happier notes, but that's where we are for tonight. I don't know where you are in your life, but having stood in the place of believing that he's a God of expectation, I'll tell you that's been one of the prayers of my heart for you guys right now, of that composite that you have in your heart and your life in regards to him and how you're operating from that place of truth and our willingness to let him rearrange those untruths that we hold about him. So I will go ahead and close in prayer, and then I will say one more thing to you about your booklets. Let's go ahead and pray. Lord God, how thankful I am that no matter what we think, what we believe about you, what we believe about ourselves, that the truth is utterly the truth with you. We are fully who we are in you, whether we can see that or not. And you are fully and truly who you are, whether we understand that or not, or only in part. God, I thank you for every woman in this room. I think of the multitude of stories that are housed just under this one roof. I think of the burdens that these women are carrying and the courage in their hearts as they face these things each day. And God, I am but a human being with a pen that has sat with you and tried to write down things as I understood them from you. I pray, God, that you would take my fishes and loaves and that you would feed them, that you would somehow, in the miraculous way that only you can do, you would take these things, you would be with them through this week, and that whatever they desire most or need most or long most for in their life right now, they would find that in you and in nothing else, God. I thank you for the desire of their heart to be here on a Monday night. I pray your blessing on them. I pray for peace as they return to homes of children and husbands. I pray for peace in spite of a late night. And I pray your blessing and your protection and, God, your great joy. I pray that tonight Romans 8 would be their takeaway. Not the hardship of my story, but Romans 8 and the promise of who you are in light of their story, God. Bless them and cover them with it. And I pray all these things in the powerful name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.